Okay, Sasha, it's time. If you are ready, I will introduce you. Mm-hmm. So it's our pleasure to welcome Alexander Litschak from Köln. You're still in Köln, right?
Yes, yes.
Köln University, and he opens this workshop week with a talk on convex subsets in generic manifold. So please.
Thank you very much. So thank you very much for the invitation, for the introduction. So it's a great honor to to be part of this workshop and to open it. So it's even more, I mean, honored by this. So I apologize in advance. I have not I haven't been to a conference for 2 years. I haven't given talks for quite long. So I hope I'm not out of training too much, so that will work somehow. So what I'm going to talk about, it's rather elementary topic, so I've decided to give this talk. And there's not too much that I'm going to say, so there's enough time for questions and discussion. So please don't hesitate to ask. So I'll start. In the title there's this word generic manifold, so I'm going to talk about typicals, about generic objects, and I start with the meta statement, which I have learned from Anton Petrunian, and he told me he has learned it in some way from Misha Gromov. So this meta statement goes like this: so that a typical object, so a generic object in the category you are used to work, this it looks very different from all examples you know. So the typical is contains many counterintuitive statements or properties, and this is what I'm going to talk about. So in a special situation. Okay, so to be a little bit more precise, so what I mean by a generic property, so usually here in this talk it will not be related to any measure theory, so it will not be something which has full measure, but it will be an intersection of open countable intersection of open dense subsets. So actually a dense set which is an intersection of open dense subsets. And so usually the space one is working in is some complex metric space, and then theorem of Baer tells you that any intersection of open dense, any countable intersection of open dense subset is dense. But it is much more than, so this property of being generic is much more than being just being dense. So and as so usually this metric space in which to which this word generic is applied, so at least for me it is some space of spaces, or some space of convex subsets, space of subsets, space of Riemannian manifolds with some properties, space of all Riemannian metrics. So usually in the right metrics, so all the spaces are complete and theorem of Baer applies. Okay. So these are the typical objects. So I will start with two examples, which are probably well known, but which are of some relevance for what I'm going to talk later. So first, how does a generic convex subset in the Euclidean space looks like? So usually the theorem. So a generic convex subset in the sense before, so it has no corners, so it has no any point of the boundary has a unique tangent plane, and but there are also no smooth points, and this convex subset is strictly convex. So slightly more precise, so this the generic boundary of a convex body is everywhere C1 but nowhere C2. So, and this is in contrast to the examples of convex subsets which come to your mind when you think about them. So either you think of something very smooth like a sphere or an ellipsoid, or you think of a polyhedron, which has lots of corners and lots of points where your subset is smooth. So this is one statement. And another statement, which is also, it is not counterintuitive, but it is again So if you are thinking about Riemann manifold, you think about Euclidean space, maybe then about the sphere, then about the hyperbolic space, then about symmetric space, so or some homogeneous spaces. So but it's so this statement is rather clear. So that if you take a generic Riemann manifold, then it does not contain totally geodesic submanifolds, but geodesics. So it's rather clear that being containing a totally geodesic submanifold is something very special. But so formally, it's not completely trivial to prove. So it's a statement due to Morte and Fred Villiers. So are there questions so far? So maybe I'll try to draw. Okay. So these are the typical convex subsets. So you either see something like a triangle, or you think of something very round. And so these are examples, you know, but the typical objects are not like this. So they look like a sphere, but not quite. So, okay. Now, a few more words about convex sets and convex hulls in Euclidean space. So first of all, so as I said before, in the Euclidean space, there are many convex polyhedra. Yeah, so you take a finite subset and take its convex hull. So then you see something with lots of corners and lots of flat faces. And there are also lots of totally geodesic subspaces, a lot of and lots of affine planes. So it's not surprising that these properties so that in generic Riemann manifolds you would not expect something like this to hold. But it's known as the theorem of Karatoderi. So it tells you that if you take any subset of the Euclidean space and take its convex hull, then any point of the convex hull you can obtain it sits in the convex hull of n plus one points simplex of your subset, and then it can be obtained by drawing connecting geodesics n times. So I will do it here. So if you start, say, with four points in the Euclidean three plane, then in the first step, so how do you build the convex hull? So you take a subset is convex if it contains with any pair of points, if it contains the shortest line between them. So you if you start with these points, the connections should be in your space. So you connect the points you have. This is the first connecting step. Now you have got new points and you have to connect all of them again. So and then you get all these faces. And in the final, in the next step, you connect any point. If you connect, it's enough to connect a vertex with the opposite face, and then you get the convex hull. So after n steps, you get the whole convex hull. So in particular, it tells you also that if you start with something compact, then the convex hull, it is the image of your set to the power n plus one, so it's compact again. So if you think about these statements, this might be something that you might expect to some extent to hold in Riemannian manifold. In particular, because if you look at the next relatives of the Euclidean planes, say if you look at the sphere, the hyperbolic space, then so the next, if you also look at any surface, then the statements are still true. So for any surface, I think either you are, say, non-positively curved, or you think locally, so that there are not too many geodesics. You might naively think that something similar is true in any Riemannian manifold. And so that's, other questions so far? I think it's an image problem. So now I'm coming to what happens in a generic Riemannian manifold. And here is the, so it's actually, so all I'm going to say, it's more or less one result. There's different, there are different possibilities to state it. So this is more or less the main result of the talk. So if you take a C2 generic Riemann manifold, so the manifold is smooth, but it is generic with respect to C2 topology. But so disregard this technicality. So if you take a generic Riemann manifold of dimension at least 3, so for surfaces, just by Jordan's curve theorem, if you take, say, 3 points, then again, at the first step, you get the boundary of a triangle, and then if you connect a point with the opposite side, you get a convex set. So, but in dimension at least 3, if you take any finite set of points, then the convex hull will be, either all of M, or it will be, so all of your points lie on a line, or the convex set is non-compact. So it means that you don't get the convex hull after n steps. You also don't get it after n plus 2 steps. You never, so you take infinitely many steps. You need infinitely many steps, and what you get then is still non-compact. So that's that's obviously, that's the result I'm going to talk about. So I don't know how surprising it is. So for me it was a bit of a surprise. So okay, so a few comments. So the topology does not play a role. So also, unlike the Euclidean space, there are in Riemannian setting there are different notions of convexity. So there's strict convexity, simple convexity, total convexity. So it doesn't play a role here. So everything is local. So the result is, it's about what happens in the neighborhood of one point. And, what I forgot to say. That's very important. I'm very sorry about it. All I'm saying is joint work. So I've mentioned his name on the very first slide, but I forgot to say it. All I'm going to talk is joint work with Anton Petrunin. So in fact, it was the observation is actually due to him. So it was, it's much more his work than mine. Okay, so I don't think that many people have thought about it, but at least some have. So in the book of Marcel Berger, so this is formulated as a question. So if it's true that the convex hull of 3 points is compact or not in most manifolds. So in fact, this is another comment. So the last comment on this page is, so the statement is actually slightly stronger. So this finiteness, the fact that we start with finitely many points does not play any role. So if you start with any convex subset, then the statement is the following. This convex hull is, it's definitely, it contains X. And then, so since you know that there are no, totally geodesic submanifolds, so then any convex set has to be full dimensional. So it has to contain an open set. So and this convex hull, so it's a union of X and open set. And there are many, a few things on the boundary which you see. But in fact, you see you see at most countably many geodesics on the boundary. So what you should maybe think of, so that we start with, again, 4 points in the three-dimensional manifolds, then if you are lucky, then these edges, they will lie on the boundary. But I also don't know how often this happens, if this happens always or... Yeah, so this doesn't happen always, but I don't know how often does it happen. So, but all other geodesics, so now in the next step, you would take, say, one of these vertex and connect it with an opposite side. But So the result tells you that, unlike what you would expect from the Euclidean intuition, so this connecting geodesic, it will lie at the end, it will be inside the convex hull. It will be in the interior of the convex hull. So you will, after a few more steps, you will find a neighborhood, containing this geodesic. Okay, so it's not maybe completely surprising. So if you take now here two geodesics nearby, then you might think so that if you connect points on them, then your first geodesic will be in the interior. So now the statement is that this is more or less always true, generically. Okay, questions so far?
Alexander, you're always drawing these pictures for finitely many points. Mm-hmm. Does it make any difference if you start with something with infinitely many points? No. Is it more or less the same thing?
It's the same. So it would also be, so if you start with a curve or with a submanifold, then you would expect, so if you take the convex hull, then what would you see? So it would be some convex part of your original manifold, and the rest will be some, so say the boundary of the convex body you would obtain. It will be part of your submanifold and then some geodesics. But that's not at all true. So in fact, most points in the boundary of the convex hull will be extremal points. There might be a few geodesics, but very few, at most countably many. Okay. So before proceeding, I will formulate a few related questions. So there are actually more. So it's not, so it's a very naive notion. So a convex subset, a convex hull, but it's surprisingly, at least so I find it surprisingly different to control them very well. So here are a few questions. So assume that the opposite is the case. So assume that this theorem of character ordering, this weak version holds true. So, and I think so. I expect so that something that this might be true. So that if the convex hull of any finite subset is compact, so then so it happens if and only if so the curvature is constant. So So if the curvature if the manifold is not simple enough, so then the convex hulls, you never get them after finitely many steps. So for any subset. So now the next question is, so we don't know an example. So if it's true, so that you can, if you really can have countably many of this geodesics on the boundary, so maybe only finitely many suffice. So on the opposite, this is the next question. So the second question is actually quite the opposite. So I don't know how to, so if you start with any Riemannian manifold, so is it, what you would expect is what I have drawn on the previous, so at least what I expect now is what I have drawn on the previous page. So if you take, at least, so you sit in a point, you take a regular simplex in the tangent space, you exponentiate it a little bit, so then you expect you are very close to the Euclidean space. Now you take this n plus one points, and you take the convex hull. Somehow you would expect that this connecting, so that these edges, that they lie on the boundary. I don't know how to prove it. So, in order to prove it, so you would need to construct some convex set, which contains these points and contains the geodesics on the geodesic on the boundary. So the problem is somehow the following. So if you are very close to a point, then you can think that your manifold is almost Euclidean. So now if you have two nearby metrics, and sufficiently high, so sufficiently good topology, then if you start with a sufficiently convex set, so if it's not just convex, but if it's so sufficiently strictly convex, if its boundary has a positive second fundamental form, so then it's clear that if you vary the metric a little bit, then it remains convex. But if you start, say, with something which is not strictly convex, has a geodesic on the boundary, so then if you vary the metric a little bit, there's no reason why for it to be convex or to be not convex. So, and I don't know at all how to control it.
Okay. Sasha, there is a question in
the chat. Yes, thank you. Is the complex hyperbolic space the convex half? I don't think so. Is it true that the complex hyperbolic space, the convex half of I should have said it. So when I talk about the convex half, so I really mean the smallest convex set containing the given set. So I don't take the closure. What is certainly true, if you are in a non-positively curved Riemann manifold or in a compact manifold, then if you take the convex hull of finitely many points, then it will be the closure of it will be compact. But in the complex hyperbolic space, I don't think it's true. But I also don't know how to prove it even for a complex hyperbolic space. So all of this is related to the following general observation. So that the convex hulls are larger than you expect them to be from your Euclidean intuition. And this is related to another question about convex sets. It's not a question in Riemannian geometry, it's a question in about Cat0 geometry, and it's due to Gromov. So it goes, so if you start with a compact subset of a Cat0 space, you take its closed convex hull now. So now you take the convex hull and take the closure. If you start with something compact, is it compact or not? So this is motivated by the fact, so that the similar result is it's a well-known fact in functional analysis. So if you start with a compact subset of a norm space, its convex hull, its closed convex hull is compact. So now you would expect, so Cat0 is in some sense as convex as a Hilbert space, and you can control the convex sets, but not enough so in order to solve this problems. So in fact, I expect that the answer is no. But so again, due to the fact that if you connect geodesics, then you go much further than you would expect to be. Are there questions? No? Then I will talk about the main observation, which proves the main result is the following one. So it's actually now a statement not about a generic Riemannian manifold, it's a statement about any Riemannian manifold, it's a statement about the behavior of a geodesic on the boundary of a convex body. So the statement is more or less that for a geodesic, if a geodesic is contained on the boundary of a convex subset, then this is a special geodesic in some sense. You have then you get some non-trivial condition along this geodesic. There are two statements. The first one is probably known for people working in Alexandrov geometry. So you take a geodesic in any convex subset. Okay, so now this C is closed and convex. Then at any point you have, okay, so here is our geodesic gamma. Here is somehow, so here is the convex, convex subset. And at each point we have the tangent cone. So this is the set of all directions such that, so here's gamma of t, and this is t gamma tc. So this is the set of all directions in the tangent space such that you can find a curve going into the convex set. So the first observation is so that this convex cone is parallel along gamma. It's important so that gamma is open, so that you don't have, so that the endpoint, so at the endpoint, certainly the tangent cone can become smaller. So if you go to a kind of vertex. So the crucial observation is the next one. So in this tangent cone, you have the maximal linear subspace. So it's at least one dimensional. So it contains dimension of this A. Is at least one because it contains the tangent direction to gamma, and at most, so it's less than the dimension of M. So, and now the statement is so that this linear subspace is invariant under the Jacobi operator. So the Jacobi operator is I use this notation, Rx, this. If you apply it to phi, this is the Riemannian curvature tensor x. So this is the Jacobi operator, which, with this you define the Jacobi fields. So now, so the statement is that this Jacobi operator, it preserves, so you see in an invariant subspace under the Jacobi operator. This is the main observation. I will say later something about the proof. Now, is the statement clear?
Alexander, I have a question. But you call the convex cone is the same as a tangent cone?
Yes. Oh, sorry. So here, So this is just a tangent cone. So this is a tangent cone, but in fact, so this tangent cone is a convex cone in the Euclidean space. Yes, sorry. So this is a tangent cone to the subset, and this is a convex cone in the Euclidean space. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So before coming to the proof, I will say, so what is so special? Why is this statement useful to say something about the, so why is it a non-trivial statement? So first of all, back. So this Jacobi operator, so it has, so it's a symmetric endomorphism. So it certainly has some invariant subspaces. So, but now the point is that if we know that this maximal linear subspace, if it's invariant at all points, now if you translate it to any point, then you also get that the derivative, that the covariant derivative of your Jacobi operator, it also preserves this A. And so what we see is that this linear subspace is invariant under all covariant derivatives. In particular, it tells us that these covariant derivatives, that they have a common invariant subspace. And this is, so, and now if you think, so if you have a generic submanifold, then these covariant derivatives, they don't have too much in common. And so it's not surprising that in a generic manifold, so this condition is almost never fulfilled. So certainly any symmetric endomorphism has the whole space as invariant subspace, and it also preserves the one-dimensional subspace generated by the geodesic. So it sends the vector, the tangent vector of the geodesic to zero. So, but if the dimension of this maximal linear subspace is not maximal and not minimal, then this condition is restrictive and becomes more and more restrictive if the derivatives grow. So, and so now the main observation is the following. So, for a generic Riemannian manifold, so the main consequence of this main observation is that if you take a generic Riemannian manifold, and you take a closed convex subset, take geodesic in this closed convex subset, then this dimension of the maximal linear space in the tangent cone is either 1 O n, the dimension of M. In the second case, so if the dimension, so if it, if the so, so if the tangent cone is the whole space, then you are in fact of the interior of M. On the other hand, there are only very few points where the dimension of this A is one, namely the set of all such points by some general nonsense is one countably rectifiable. So in fact, the set of all points where the dimension of this maximal linear subspace is at most one, it is a union of at most countably many geodesics. These are the countably many geodesics which appear in the main theory. So the statement can be now restated as the following. So if you take a generic Riemann manifold and you see a geodesic on the boundary, then this must be really an edge. So along this geodesic, the tangent cone has only splits only a one-dimensional Euclidean subspace. So there are no also infinitesimally there are no surfaces going through this point. No questions so far? No? Okay. Then I will say a few words about the proof. So I will prove this observation. So this will be essentially the only thing I will prove. And so the proof is very elementary, but it contains some observation which maybe very elementary but maybe useful. Okay, so first observation. So assume, so again remember, so we have here our gamma, we have here our convex space, convex subset, here's a point gamma of t. So this is gamma of t plus, this is gamma of t minus. And here somewhere.
Sorry, Sasha, there is another question in the chat.
Sorry. Please, what do you mean by rectifiable? So it's if you don't know what it is, it's not important. So for us, it's really the statement that the image is contained in. So for this was so sorry. Okay. So when k is equal to 1, this is the relevant case for us. It means that this set of all points x, where the dimension of the tangent space is splits at most R, it's at most one-dimensional subspace of it, is a union of countably many geodesics. So in general, countably rectifiable means, so that is a union of images of finitely many, countably many images of Lipschitz maps from a k-dimensional, from a subspace of a k-dimensional Euclidean space. But for us, it's really much more elementary. Okay. To the first observation. So first observation is the following. So assume we have the J is a Jacobi field along gamma. Jacobi field along gamma. And assume so that we have three points. So we have t minus, smaller than t plus. And assume that we have here, so the Jacobi field has some value at t minus and some values at t plus, and assume that g of t plus minus is contained in the tangent cone to the convex subset. So then, also at the point t, the value of the Jacobi field is contained in the tangent cone to t. Why is that? Now, yeah, what is a Jacobi field? This is just a derivative of of a family of geodesics. And by convexity, the geodesics between two points in C are contained in C for all time. So if we start here with a curve which lies in C and at a point T plus with a curve which lies completely in C, then the connecting geodesics also lie in T, and then the corresponding Jacobi field will also be in the tangent cone to the convex set at all times. This is the first very elementary but useful observation. Okay. Now a more essential one. This is a statement about the parallel translation along gamma. This is, I think, this observation is more or less due to Cantor. Then it was used in different settings by Nikolaev, by Petrunin. So whenever you want to understand what is the parallel transport in a setting where you don't have it immediately, so then you better first understand what is the parallel transport in the Riemannian setting in a more hands-on way than by using a covariant derivative. And there are two ways of saying it. So the first way is the following. So here's your gamma. And if you want to understand, if you want to say what is the parallel translation, so here's gamma of A, here's gamma of B. You want to parallel translate a vector V from gamma of A to gamma of B along gamma. Now, how do you do this? There are two ways. So one, this is, I think, so you subdivide, first you subdivide your interval, and then you take, so the first one is variometric. So it does not use Jacobi fields. It's very, so you go in the direction of V a little bit, and now you take a reflection at this point. Then you take the reflection at the next point. Then you take a composition just of geodesic reflections. Yeah. And then you arrive here. And now the point is so that you arrive at some point Vn, where n describes the number of steps in which you subdivide your interval. And this is the observation due to Cantor that Vn converges to the parallel transport of V. You should be a little bit more precise here, because it's only true if you, at the same time, if you make the vector V smaller and smaller. So now what we really use is similar, but a little bit more elementary. So again, we have here gamma of A, we have here gamma of B. And now we take here a vector V. Again, we subdivide the geodesic in intervals of the same length. And now we proceed as following. So we call, so this is gamma of T1. And here we say T2, here we say T3, T4, and so on. Here we say his point Tk, Tk plus 1. Is tk plus 2. Now we define the new vectors inductively. How do we do this? Now, yeah, we consider a Jacobi field which mimics these connecting lines. So we take a Jacobi, so we start with V1 equal to V, and now we take the Jacobi field, which is the unique Jacobi field such that at the point T1 it's equal to V, and at the point T3 is zero. And then we evaluate it at the point T2, and we expect that it's more or less the half of V, and then we double it. And so we say then V2 is two times, so this is G1 T2. And then they proceed in the same way. This is the three, and so on. And at each step, we do the same. Here's some vk, and at the end, we arrive at some vn. And now the observation is so that that if you let n go to infinity, and vn converges to the parallel translation along of v along gamma. So it's actually very easy to understand also. So at each point you make an error, but this error is of order n square, and now you have only n times n of this error. So the error is goes to zero if n goes to infinity. So I think if you've never seen it, this is this is something which is useful. So, okay. And now comes the last step. So already using the first two steps, it's easy to see. So because we can understand parallel translation by drawing geodesics, and in these steps, so if we have here vk and here we have zero, then by induction vk is contained in the tangent space, the point tk to c, and zero is contained in certainly also in the corresponding tangent space, then it tells you that by the first observation that all vectors we construct in this way are contained in the tangent space to C. And this tells you also so that the parallel transport of V is contained in T gamma T of C for all T. So this again. So what have we done? We have understand parallel translation. So either in terms of geodesic reflection, connecting geodesics, or in terms of Jacobi fields. And what we have observed first, that if we have a Jacobi field, which is tangent to your convex set at boundaries, then also everywhere in between. And this provides us with the first result. And the second one is, so how do we get that this linear subspace is invariant under the Jacobi operator? This is also not very difficult. So we do the following. So we fix T, so let T be fixed. And now we identify the tangent spaces at all points. Now we take any tangent vector. At the end, we let epsilon go to zero, and we construct the Jacobi field, which if we go from epsilon plus minus from T epsilon to the right and epsilon to the left, this is exactly the vector V, which is at T gamma T plus minus epsilon of C. Then this Jacobi field, it's also tangent to C at the point T. And now it's a not very difficult observation that the value of such a Jacobi field at T for sufficiently small epsilon, it's actually V plus 1/2 epsilon square air gamma prime of V. But now letting epsilon go to zero, I write it here in the top. What it tells us that if you apply the Jacobi operator to any tangent vector to your convex set, then what you see, so this is by the first step, this is in the tangent space to C. And so what you see that this is in the tangent space to the tangent cone. But now, so in general, this condition is not very easy to grasp. So say in for such a space, so if this would be your convex subset, then in the interior, it would say nothing. At the boundary point, say if this would be V, it would tell you that the image of V is here on the left, in the left half plane, and on top of this W, it would be on the other half plane. So, but if V is contained in your maximal linear subspace, then the tangent space at V, then this is equal, in fact, to the tangent contour to your original space. And you can also apply, so then it tells you that the image of V is contained in the tangent space, but you can also apply it to minus V. And so the image of minus V is minus the image of V. So it also contained in the tangent cone. And whenever you have a vector such that the vector and it's, yeah, if it's negative, is contained in the tangent cone, then it means that your vector is contained in a maximal Euclidean space. And so it tells you that the image V is contained in A. So that's actually all I wanted to say about the proof. Are there questions so far? No? Okay, then a few final comments about property of being generic. So it's again, so a simple meta statement. So a generic Riemannian manifold does not satisfy non-trivial curvature condition. So what does it mean non-trivial? Now, yeah, so the curvature tensor has some symmetries, and so also its derivatives have some symmetries, and there are some connections between them. But if, but besides of them, if you take a generic Riemannian manifold, if it's sufficiently high topology, then at no point no special condition will be satisfied. So here for us it reads like the following: so there exists some number k, depending on the dimension, and in fact, so it can be in principle it can be computed explicitly. And yeah, so we haven't checked it, but I think it's a rather small number in our case. So such that if we have CK plus, so such that the set of Riemannian metrics for which there exists a linear space at some point, such that this linear space is invariant under the Jacobi operator and the first k derivatives of this Jacobi operator simultaneously. So this condition is generically not fulfilled. So there's no point P, there's no vector V such that there is a linear subspace invariant under the Jacobi operator and its derivatives at the same time. So that's the specific formulation of this meta statement for us. And how does one prove something like this? This is the last slide. So in fact, one uses Thom's transversality theorem. So the Thom's transversality theorem. So it the statement about, so you think of a metric as a section of some bundle, and Thom's transversality theorem, it tells you that if you control things at one point, you can control them simultaneously everywhere. So also so that if you control the space of jets of metrics at a point P, so if you can say that if you consider the germs of metrics at a given point in a given space, and if you can prove that this condition, that at this fixed point there is the condition that having a vector and such that and a subspace which is invariant under all Jacobi operators or Jacobi operator and its derivatives at the same time, if this subset is has sufficiently high codimension, larger than the dimension of the manifold, then you know that the space of Riemannian metrics satisfying this condition is open and dense. Okay, so openness is for free, so then you know that it is dense. Okay, and so the final piece is essentially known but not too well known statement is that so if you consider an assignment, so you start with the Riemannian metric and you take its you fix a point, take its first k derivatives and assign to it the Jacobi operator at each direction and the derivatives of the Jacobi operator, so the first so then you get k minus two tuple of Jacobi operators. So and so the statement is that this map is a submersion. So that whenever you have some statement, whenever you have some statements about symmetric endomorphism, then you can lift it generically to Riemannian metrics. Okay. So the point is so that you can assign So if you vary the Riemannian tensor, more or less, in an indivisible way, then you get, it's possible to find a variation of Riemannian metrics, which produces this variation of Riemannian tensors. So, but I don't want to be here too explicit. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Alexander. Thank you for this nice talk. Even after 2 years, it's good. So, are there any questions in the room? Well, so there are no questions. Thank you very much again. And next talk is at 5:30 p.m. Paris time.
So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Sasha.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye. Goodbye. Thank you.